Nidhi, I'm starting recording. I think you can take notes.
All right.
Guys, have your cameras on, please?
Hi, guys. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, so today the experiments we'll be covering is comparator, zero crossing detector, time marker detector, and sample and hold. And at this point, I'm hoping you at least know that these names exist, which is about how much you'll need to know to understand these experiments. So we're going to start by actually, I'm going to close this LTSpice window and open our window where we have the op-amp characteristics. And the reason these characteristics are so important for this experiment is that till now we've been operating our op-amp in the middle linear region. This is where we've been operating our op-amp because we actually want to avoid the saturation. So that's why we've been using that negative feedback method so that we can control the amplifier gain and keep it in this region. However, for the comparator, we're actually going to use the saturation region that exists in the op-amp. And I'm going to show you how. So first thing we're going to do is build the comparator circuit. Now, like I've mentioned in the past, you can use any op-amp that you want, but I'm going to be using the 741 today. Okay, so somebody had asked me a doubt last time. I think yesterday I received a doubt on my DM, which was that how do you get the signal voltage source? And the answer is there's two ways to get to it. So the first way to get to it is you go to components and you just type in signal. So that way you get the signal voltage source here. But the other way to obtain it is actually you just right click on your regular voltage source and then you click on advanced. And when you do that, it gives you these really complicated looking options, which are not that complicated after all, because you just have to click this sign button right here and you can enter the values and get the same kind of voltage source as the signal voltage source. It'll still look like this regular plus minus DC voltage source, but it behaves like a signal voltage source. So you can use either of these methods. There's no right or wrong way to do it. So yeah, that's that. All right, now that we're done with building the circuit, I'm just going to connect in the wires. And then we are going to pick a reference voltage and a value for the sine voltage that we're providing. As you can see here, I am not providing any feedback path because, like I mentioned, we are going to be using the open loop gain of this op-amp. Till then, if someone can tell me what the open loop gain of the 741 is.
The nearest to 5, right?
I believe it's actually 200,000.
Yes.
Yeah.
So that's 2×10^5, somewhere around that.
Oh, I did not hear him say the 2. I think that's why.
Yeah.
Okay. So right now we're going to pick the reference voltage as about 5 volts, and I can give my sine wave a peak voltage of 8 volts. And we're going to take 100 hertz for now, low frequency preferably. I'm just going to drag around a few of these things so you can see the circuit more easily. Right. So this is our basic comparator circuit. Since y'all have studied comparators, if one of you can tell me whether this is a non-inverting comparator or an inverting comparator.
Non-inverting.
That's right, it is a non-inverting comparator. It was a 50-50 guess. Was it a guess or was it a thought out answer?
No, I actually knew.
Okay, great. Right, so I'm simply going to run this, and we are going to be using, I think at this point, I don't need to ask you all this because you all know that we run a transient analysis for this. So I'm going to take a stop time of 20 milliseconds, should be good. And we're first going to sample the input, then we're going to sample the reference voltage, and then we're going to sample the output voltage. So as you can see, at each place where the input voltage matches the reference voltage or crosses it, there is a crossing from negative saturation to positive saturation for the same kind of transition in the input wave, and from positive saturation to negative saturation for, again, a positive to negative switch in the input wave. Now, if we were making an inverting comparator, it would be the other way around. But right now we're using a non-inverting comparator. As you can see here, we are receiving a wave that's sort of pulse width modulated. So one of the applications of this circuit is obviously pulse width modulation. Now I'm actually going to show you all something. What is going to happen if I change this frequency to say 1 kilohertz? I'm changing this frequency to 1 kilohertz, and we should probably change the simulation time too. So I'm going to edit the simulation command and change this to maybe 5 milliseconds. Yeah, let's see this. Now you can see that you're kind of able to see this triangular shape forming in the waveform, and you can see that it's not a perfect square waveform. And this happens because of one parameter of the op-amp. Does anyone know which parameter of the op-amp causes this problem?
Slew rate?
Yeah, it is slew rate. So the 741 has a slew rate of, I believe, 0.5 volts per microsecond, which I don't expect you all to know by heart, but this slew rate is fairly slow when it comes to op-amps, which is why higher frequencies cause this problem. But at a frequency of 1 kilohertz, it's still fine. Now, what's going to happen if I further increase the frequency to 5 kilohertz? The op-amp, again, I'm going to change the simulation command. Now, as you can see, the output waveform of the op-amp is not even reaching saturation, positive saturation, before switching. And that is because the slew rate is so slow that it's kind of just switching midway before it reaches saturation. Now, if I further increase this to say 100 kilohertz, which is a very likely frequency to have in practical circuits. Now, the output waveform is barely even crossing beyond, what is it, 13 minus 13 volts. It's just appearing as a ripple in the output waveform. So based on this, I think you can tell what one of the biggest drawbacks of our comparator is. It's that it cannot deal with higher frequencies. And one of the solutions that we use for this is actually a circuit called the Schmitt trigger, which you will be studying in later practicals. But another solution we use for this is simply using comparator ICs. There are people who have developed specialized comparator ICs that have such a high slew rate that this problem does not occur with higher frequencies. So that is another solution of that problem. There is, however, one more drawback of the comparator, if anyone remembers. It's something that I won't be able to show you all in this circuit, but it's something that will exist only in practical circuits. Guys, come on, what exists practically that does not exist in simulation?
Offset.
Okay, yeah, offset is definitely one of the problems.
Noise.
Yes, okay, yeah, noise is the biggest problem. Now, think about it. If there was a noise in my signal right here and it had an upward spike, my output signal would cross to the other side for maybe like a very, very small amount of time and then again switch back up. And this is creating unnecessary switches. And when you use this for applications such as pulse width modulation, that extra switch will actually count. Or suppose you're using the comparator actually as a counter. Let's say that your count will increase by one because of that extra switch, and that is going to cause a lot of problems in your circuit. So that is another drawback of our comparator. Now we're just simply going to study.
Nidhi, could you show that particular thing on Paint just so that, because possibly I doubt that they would have understood the noise switch. Would you want to show it on Paint or do you want me to?
No, actually, I can show it on Paint.
Yeah, perfect.
Right. It's been a while since I used Paint. I'm not exactly sure how to.
No, use the brush. Yeah. Okay.
Brush.
Yeah, that just helps.
I'm going to draw our input in, say, green color. And see, that was a fluctuation in our input. Please excuse my drawing skills, guys. It's not my strong point. And that is our reference voltage. I'm not going to even try writing VREF. Okay, so our output voltage, which we can do in, say, purple. Now it'll switch once at this point. So I'm going to take that up here. Then it'll switch here. Then it'll switch here. And then the moment you see that this little noise fluctuation is actually creating another switch here. So this will reach here, switch again, and then again, now that the noise fluctuation is coming up, it'll switch again. And this is the kind of error that I'm talking about that happens because of, we'll use an eraser for that. And this is the kind of error that happens because of noise. Now that noise is actually triggering an extra switch. So do you guys see the problem, or does someone need me to explain it or draw it better, maybe?
Guys, have you all understood this?
Yes, sir.
If all of you all realize this, the number of times that the noise crosses that particular reference voltage, those many number of times an extra pulse is going to be created, right? And if you're doing basically a pulse width modulation and you're supposed to have only, let's say, two rotations of the motor, you're going to possibly have an extra number of rotations because of this particular cycle, because your time, your on time of your system has changed, right? So instead of two pulses, you may be having four or five pulses that are jumping in, right? So that's a major problem with these sort of comparators. And noise can be activated on your positive reference line, negative reference line. It doesn't see any sort of reference line, right? It can just trigger anywhere on the positive side and the negative side, and it will just cause a switch based on whether you're using a positive or a negative reference, right? Anyone, any questions over here to Nidhi or to me? But I think we're pretty clear on this. Anyone, any questions? Yeah, okay, Nidhi, I think we can proceed.
Okay, this problem is actually even more alleviated in the zero crossing detector, because in the zero crossing detector, if you have periods in the input where there is no input being applied to the circuit, it can be the noise itself that actually triggers the circuit and causes switching. So this problem is even more visible in the zero crossing detector. So speaking of the zero crossing detector, we are just going to modify this circuit to actually implement the zero crossing detector. And the easiest way to modify is we remove this and we just connect this wire. Actually, before doing that, I wanted to show you all one more thing. So a lot of websites will actually show you a different way of drawing the circuit, and that is that they actually just, I'm going to remove this and duplicate VCC, should I? Okay, so they take the reference from between VCC and VEE. And this is actually a very good way of practically drawing the circuit, because you can, using a voltage divider circuit, you can actually take the, I think I drew this wrong. Yeah. Using a voltage divider circuit, you can actually take the values of, like, the value of reference voltage from there. So you don't have to use a separate voltage source to do it. So since we have taken a reference voltage of 5 volts, the using like a little bit of simple calculation, you can obtain that I need my higher resistor to be of about what was it, like 1.1 kilo ohms, and my lower resistor can be 2.2 kilo ohms. And I have to label the net.
Guys, have you all understood why she has done this? There's a very, very interesting reason of doing this. Anyone, possibly from a designer's perspective, what has she done that helps in possibly explaining why she is using those two resistors? Have you understood what she has done? Yes, no. She has replaced the V reference with a potential divider circuit. My question is, how does it help?
It helps by minimizing current flowing and hence heat loss.
Nope. Always look at it from the perspective of money. Always look at it from the perspective of supply constraints, power supply constraints. You pushing in two resistors versus you pushing in an extra source. What's more convenient? What's more in terms of economy? What's better?
Pushing in two resistors because they cost lesser than a voltage source.
So not just cost lesser, if you realize that I putting in a supply source, right, is going to be a tremendous amount of protection that needs to be provided to that, a dV by dt protection or a di by dt protection may need to be added, right? Supply constraints come into picture. You will have something called as a supply voltage rejection ratio, which is suddenly an added parameter into this, right? You don't want that additional supply causing more havoc in your circuit. So what are you doing? You already have a VCC and VEE, right? Why not just take that same particular thing and create a V reference out of it, right? So if you're looking at basically a minus V ref, you're going to be using that minus VEE out over there. If you want a plus V ref, you're going to be using that plus VCC out over there, right? So that just helps you save on one fact, is that your resistances will always occupy a minimal footprint, right? As opposed to a power supply being brought in. So that's a very interesting change in design that happens when we actually switch over from theoretical to practical circuits. Yeah, Nadi, go ahead, please.
Yeah, so that was a really interesting insight. Even I learned something new today. The only reason I thought we did this was because we didn't do practicals offline, obviously, in this college. But when I was in VJTI, I remember that we used to beg the uncles in the lab for voltage sources and they didn't have any extra. So we
would exactly. So that's how, if you realize that you always will have. So if you have a VCC and VE, right, you're already using one particular source. Right now, you want one more source for this particular thing. And that's just for VREF, right? So a practical consideration will always be to figure out. So that's the reason why op-amps also have single supply biasing, right? Why do we require single supply biasing? It's because of however much we can reduce power supplies,
that's the beauty of the circuit, because that's going to save you a lot of cost, EMI interference, and all of these aspects. Right?
Yes, sir.
Good.
So yeah, that was just a small insight. Very, very informational, actually. So thank you, sir. I'm going to remove these resistors again so we can actually get to the zero crossing detector. We can leave the VCC and VEE in that place. There's no problem with that apart from it not being aesthetically pleasing. And I'm just going to add a ground here. So this is the simple modification that converts our comparator to a zero crossing detector, and the only difference you can see in the waveform is that our reference voltage is now 0 volts. So this actually creates a square wave. I don't know why this is not plotting the 0 volts. All right, we know the reference is at 0 volts, so we're going to imagine it's there. Yeah, as you can see, though, that's not what I meant to happen. As you can see, the output is now switching at 0 volts, and you get a duty cycle in this output waveform of 50%. Do you guys know what a duty cycle is? Anyone have any doubt regarding what a duty cycle is? Okay, so a duty cycle essentially is the on time, which is this little thing. So the on time of a circuit divided by the total time period of your circuit, of your waveform. So the on time and the off time are equal, which means that the duty cycle will be 1/2 or 50%. And this is creating your 50% square wave, which is not pulse width modulator, unlike the comparator. So this is a simple zero crossing detector. Like I mentioned, the Schmidt trigger will solve the problems of the zero crossing detector that we saw earlier. So I'm just going to skim over this part pretty quickly. Next up, we are going to observe a circuit called the time marker detector. And I'm just going to create a modification in this circuit itself. Let's tidy up this maybe. Second, guys, while I build the circuit. Okay, so we see a few familiar circuits here. So can anyone point out the three different circuits that you see in here? There's three different circuits within this one circuit. Can anyone identify that?
A filter.
Okay, yeah, there's a filter.
And I think a rectifier.
Yeah, there's a rectifier, and then the first one we just studied. Okay, it's a zero crossing detector, okay. Yeah. You all probably guessed it, but I'm just too shy to speak. So we're going to combine these three stages to create something called a time marker detector. I'm going to add a label for V out here. And then we can actually observe the waveform for this. Oh, I forgot to add. Okay, we're just going to add some standard values of 1 kilo ohm and 1 microfarad. And our load resistor we can just have as 10 kilo ohms. And yeah, that seems older. Input. And let's see our intermediate outputs. We can delete this one. Okay. And I'm just going to increase the time of this so we can view a few more cycles. So I'm going to change the time to start saving data for this to 10 milliseconds, and that's because I want to avoid the transient period of this. So as you can see, the first cycle of this looks a little different from the second cycle, and that's because our circuit is going through its transient stage. So let's just try to avoid seeing that for now. Yeah. This is what our time marker detector looks like, and what our time marker detector is actually supposed to do is it's supposed to give us these pulses to show us each time period ka beginning for the circuit. But these are not looking a lot like spikes or pulses. And the reason for this is because we actually need to modify the values of this capacitor and resistor. So I'm gonna change, so have I put the capacitor and resistor in the wrong form?
So C is going to bypass your system. R2, C2, R1 and C1 is out of here. Nope, I think this looks all right. Let me just confirm. Yeah, just let me confirm.
Sir, in the RIAS PDF, it's the other
way. I think either C or Hona Chahiye, but let me confirm just one second. Does somebody have that particular PDF open in front of them?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yeah. Can you just put a screenshot of that on the chat section?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, yeah, the capacitor. Because what the C would have done, Nidhi would be basically taking that and pushing that to ground. So
yeah,
that's why it wouldn't be working.
Yeah, I think I created a low pass filter by accident. Okay, yeah, that's correct. So I believe someone wanted to ask you something.
Sorry?
I just heard someone saying your name. Okay. Yeah, so as you can see now, this is looking a bit more like the spikes that we want to see, but these are still not spikes. They're still looking non-spiky. I don't know how else to explain it. So essentially what we're supposed to do is we're supposed to adjust the values of the capacitor and resistor here in order to adjust the cutoff frequency of the circuit so that we can create a spike. So I'm just going to go ahead and try increasing this capacitance first, and let's see what happens. This is not even looking as much of a spike as it looked earlier. So clearly high is not the way to go. So let's try going lower. And now we can see that we're obtaining a bit more of a spike, which is how our time marker generator output is supposed to look. And now I'm just going to adjust the value of the resistor and see what happens. So let's try 470 ohms. That's kind of reducing the amplitude of the pulse, which is not what we want. So I'm going to change that to, let's try 1.5 kilo ohms. And I feel like that seems like a good place to be. So yeah, what we actually did with the circuit is we're actually tuning the circuit. So we're changing the values to adjust it to the best possible value for ourselves. And that is how I obtain these values of 0.1 micro and 1.5 kilo ohms. If anyone has a calculator with you, you can actually calculate the cutoff frequency of the circuit. The formula is 1 by 2 pi RC, and you can put that in your experiment. I believe even we had calculated it and put it in the experiment. So is there any other explanation required for this circuit?
No, I don't think so. This okay. Perfectly works.
So I'm going to close this and...
So Nidhi, even if the, just a quick thing, even if the resistor values drop down a bit, that's not going to be a problem because a higher value of R at 1.5 causes a stronger power dissipation, right? And also it's going to cause a second particular thing, which is the discharge time of this particular thing will be higher, right? Because the RC time constant changes to a higher value. So even if the ideation is between a balance between R and C, such that C should not be very high, because the higher the C, the charging and discharging time constant depends on that. And the R value should be such that it should prevent two things. One, it should not provide an extremely fast dissipation. So if you put 470 ohms or 800 ohms, it's going to have a very fast discharge. So anything even in the 1 kilo ohms range is always okay for this particular thing. So it's a balance. It's a balance between, charging time constant and power dissipation over here. Nidhi, I think you're on mute.
Yes, sir, please just give me a second.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that seems to be working fine too, but I think the spike is in microvolts though. So I have to adjust the...
Sorry, what's the value of R that you've kept?
10 ohms.
No, not 10 ohms. So I said that it has to be somewhere in the 900 to 1 kilo ohms.
Oh, 900 to 1 kilo ohms. Sorry, sir. I heard like 1 ohm. So,
no.
Okay. So, 1 kilo ohm should be fine. And then we can leave this at our 100 nano value. Yeah. That seems like a good value. You guys can feel free to adjust it based on the software that you're using, because I remember last year I was using Multisim and my friend was using OrCAD and a lot of other people were using LTSpice, and we were getting different shapes of our waveform in all the simulation tools. So kind of adjust your RC values according to what works best with your simulation tool too. And then now we're moving on to the last circuit of today, which is the sample and hold circuit, which is actually one of my favorite circuits that I studied in DLIC. So I hope you like it too. But before that, I'm going to ask you all a very, very difficult question. And that is, do you all remember EDC? Don't feel shy, guys. I've studied it too. You can say if you don't.
Yes.
Okay, I heard a yes and a no at the same time. It's okay, that pretty much captures the mood of EDC, so I get that. I'll explain to you the basics of it, but we're going to be using an NMOS in this circuit. And that's why I asked you all the question.
So I think let's not go in those territories.
I'm going to try to explain as little as possible. We don't really need to know that much about the NMOS. So it's okay if you don't
do. So, however, Nidhi, if you realize that the whole of EDC characteristics is the beauty behind VLSI, right? If you do not know NMOS, if you do not know PMOS, or if you do not know structural characteristics, what it creates is a problem when you're doing filters. when you're doing ISD, when you're doing VLSI, all of these particular subjects, right?
So 100%, sir. We realized it a little too late, so we spent every semester just studying EDC last minute.
Right.
Okay, so I'm just going to go ahead and can somebody tell me what circuit is it that I have built in the start here? Anybody? Come on, guys. Circuit. What did you say?
A buffer.
Yeah, that's a buffer. A buffer or a voltage follower is another word we use for it. And I'm going to explain why we've used that later, but for now, we are just going to build a circuit.
So just one quick thing, Nidhi, since you broached that particular topic.
Mm-hmm.
Guys, this is how your semester is going to go in terms of your test, right? So now that we are going to be in that particular zone also, I'm going to give you such kind of circuits, all right? Your job would be to identify them. That's going to be your exam. So basically, you can't pass anything through WhatsApp. You can't, until and unless you don't know identifying the circuits, you won't be able to figure out what circuit you are in. So each particular batch gets a different type of circuit. You identify it and then you create a, so I'll be creating a sum on that. And that is what you solve, right? So ideally, you should be able to identify each circuit on the fly. And if you realize that as you progress in DLIC, you will be studying a minimum of 100 circuits. By the time you finish, I don't know if Nidhi, you all ever remembered this, but you all study more than 100 circuits by the time you finish off DLIC. So
I don't think it ever struck us, but now that you say it,
yeah, that's the number of circuits that you all will be looking at. So always please push in a habit to draw the circuit. All right. I'm repeating this at this point of time because this particular thing I will be doing from your term test 2 onwards, where I will take up a particular circuit, push in an image of out of that and create a sum on the basis of that particular question, right? So ideally, if you identify the circuit itself wrong, your formulas, every particular aspect with it goes wrong, right? So you identify an integrator as a differentiator, you apply all the formulas that are related to a differentiator, and basically you end up with a zero, right? So please be in a habit to identify circuits, draw the circuits, and make sure that you write waveforms below, write the formulas below it. Yeah, Nadi, go ahead, please.
So just excuse me for a second.
Sure.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, Yash.
Sir, can I ask a doubt till then?
Yeah, go ahead. I think Nadi is also. Go ahead.
Sir, as Nidhi showed that in the comparator circuit, we can also connect like two resistors in a voltage follower, in a voltage divided configuration. So in the practicals, we have to connect V in or we have to connect the resistors.
Oh, ideally you should connect the resistors. Ideally you should always connect the resistors.
Yeah, because yesterday you told that we have to take V in as 2 volts and if we connect the resistors, then it will be 15 volts.
Right. So that is for simulations, that's a different thing. When I'm going to give you on practicals, it will be a completely different setup.
So, sir, in the simulations, what you have to do?
In the simulation, you can work with 1 volts or 2 volts as a reference. It shouldn't be a problem.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, Nidhi, go ahead, please.
For this, just to clarify, for the simulation of the comparator, it really doesn't matter what voltage. So for the reference voltage, as long as it's anything less than your input voltage, it should be good. Otherwise,
go ahead.
That's it, sir. That's all I wanted to say. Like I was mentioning earlier today about the signal voltage source. So again, I have placed the signal voltage source here, but you can place the regular voltage source and click on advanced too. You see a lot of different functions here. and the one we've been using till now is the sine function. But today we're actually going to be using something called the pulse function. And this is because we need to provide input pulses to our NMOS. So I'm going to take my initial voltage as minus 10. And we can take our V on as plus 10. I don't need that plus. T delay is, we don't need to add any delay there. We can take our time period as 1 millisecond, and we can take our on time as 0.5 milliseconds. So as you can see here, we don't really have to add a frequency. Instead, they're telling us to add time period. So you're going to have to do a little bit of mental calculation here. And the reason you have to do mental calculation is because we need to make sure that this is following Nyquist criteria. So y'all are studying principles of communication, right? The STEM or some form of communication subject.
I'm not sure on that. Rashmi, do you have a subject on principles of communication or digital communication, anything?
So we had ADC.
Okay. No. Forget EDC. Okay. Did you all have Nyquist criterion by any chance in anything?
Digital communication we had in on the last sem.
Yes, sir. We had the sampling theorem.
Okay. Yeah. So they have an idea, Nidhi.
All right. Perfect. I just wanted to know because, yeah. So Nyquist criteria essentially states that my input frequency is FB, then my pulse, like the pulses that I'm giving here. The frequency should be a minimum of 2 times that frequency. And that it is over here. So we can just click OK. I'm first going to explain the working of the circuit so you guys can get an idea, and then I'll run it and show you the output. So at the input, we have a voltage follower, which means it passes the same voltage to its output. This voltage is then applied to a switch, which is our NMOS here. And this NMOS gate is triggered by pulses. So whenever the positive pulse hits this, it passes the input waveform through it onto this capacitor, which then starts charging with that waveform. Also, this entire waveform will appear across the output. Because again, the input at this voltage follower is the output of the voltage follower too. However, when my positive pulse gets over here and goes to the negative pulse, the NMOS is not triggered anymore, which means that its input will not pass to the output. So what will appear across V out is the charge that is already existing on the capacitor. So when you see the output waveform of this, you'll be able to see it better. So I am going to run this circuit and let's see what happens. So this is the input and this is the output. That is not what it looks like. I think most of you will know what a sample and hold output should look like. So why does it not look like what it's supposed to look like? Any ideas? Let's try troubleshooting here together. Can anyone help me figure out why it's not looking like this? Okay, first of all, do you guys agree that this is not what a sample and hold circuit output should look like?
Yes.
Yeah, y'all have studied sample and hold circuits in digital communication, so y'all know what it looks like, and it's not this. So now let's look at the elements in this circuit and see what could possibly be causing this problem. Is there any element that could be creating this problem for us?
Capacitor?
Yeah, capacitor. Whenever there's a problem, we blame it on the capacitor, and you're fair to do that. So the capacitance value here is 1 microfarad, which means that, again, this capacitor is going to need a little tuning. So let's try a couple of different options. Let me try reducing this to 100 nanofarads. Let's see what happens. Do we see an improvement? Do I still need to reduce it further? Okay, I see someone nodding, so that must be a yes. Let's try 10 nanofarads. And it's looking even better. I'm going to reduce it once more to 1 nanofarad and let's see what happens. Please excuse me, I'm going to have a little water. are we satisfied with this output now? What do you all think? Are you all satisfied? Do we need to reduce it further?
I guess, yes.
Yeah, I'm satisfied with it too, because this is how a sample and hold output should look like. Oh, you weren't satisfied with it. Okay, no, that's okay. If you're not satisfied, we can reduce it further. I mean, y'all are the ones helping me troubleshoot this circuit, so let's reduce it further. Do we see a problem that's happening here? Are you satisfied with it now?
Yeah, yes. I mean, is this
better than what I had done earlier? No.
The whole part is a little...
Yeah, so now that you're reducing it a little too much, it is again beginning to get distorted, but in a different way, which is the exact point of tuning. You need to find that perfect value of the capacitor that gives you the output that you desire. So yeah, we are going to go with 1 nanofarad, which is giving us possibly our best output. I know that this little part on the like falling edge is still looking a little dicey, but I've tried adjusting the values and this is the best we're going to get. So I'm just going to go ahead and remove the input waveform so we can see just this. So yeah, this is how a sample and hold circuit is working. Let's add the input waveform and see. Now, possibly after seeing the waveform, you'll are able to understand my explanation better. Because as you can see, let's add the pulses to this too, actually. Yeah. So as you can see, whenever there is a positive edge, the waveform keeps rising. And whenever there's a negative edge, this kind of holds its value. And that is because the capacitor maintains the charge. So now I have a question for you. Why the voltage followers? Think about it.
Can you please repeat the question?
So I've used 1 voltage follower at the input and 1 at the output. Why have I used voltage followers? Why did I just not put a simple input to the NMOS and an output from the capacitor?
Because MOSFET only works on the principle of the voltage, not on the current.
Okay, that's interesting thinking, but it's not the right answer this time.
Unity gain?
But unity gain can be given by a simple circuit. If I just put a wire in place of that voltage follower, it will also give me unity gain.
Input impedance?
Now we're talking. So tell me your thought process when you said input impedance.
Like basically, if it is less than, there will be voltage drop. Like I mean that it should, the circuit should be in the state that it can drive any signal.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. So the reason we're actually putting the voltage follower here is to isolate the input and output from the middle of the circuit. Because if you think about it, then if those op-amp voltage followers weren't there, the capacitor could have discharged out of either side. So what this high input impedance is doing is actually maintaining that voltage value in the middle. So whoever said voltage drop had, I think you were beginning to get a little bit of the point. But yeah, the reason we're doing this is to actually isolate the input stage, the middle sampling stage, and then the output stage. So if there's anything you'd like to add to this explanation, then...
I think the answer explanation comes from the same explanation, guys, that I gave you during instrumentation amplifier, right? The difference between a difference amplifier out there and an instrumentation amplifier. And when you look at the input impedance of a buffer, right, you are always seeing an infinity of input impedance, right? So that's what is needed. Because for a differential amplifier, I mentioned to you all that the resistance is always finite in nature. For an instrumentation amplifier, when I explained to you all, I told you all that when you're standing at the input terminals of the op-amp, you will see infinite resistance because V is IR, right? And the current entering into the input terminals of an op-amp is zero, right? So when you're seeing that R is equal to VA by I, and I is 0 in the denominator. So R is V by I. In the denominator, you have a 0. 0 in the denominator means an infinity is present. So R is basically equal to infinity, which means that your impedance is infinity, right? So it won't allow the capacitor to discharge in the second stage, which means the capacitor holds the particular last value, right? So you're doing sample, okay? So you're sampling the input. You wait for a particular amount of time, which is called as hold, and then you sample again, right? So for holding that value, you require that the capacitor does not discharge. And how does it not discharge? You don't give it a low discharge path ever, right? So that's how the sample and hold works. At the input side, you have the buffer because you can drive it from any signals that you would want, which is low value signals and so on and so forth. At the output stage, it is allowing to ensure that the capacitor holds on to that particular prior value and only discharges when the pulse comes in from that particular MOSFET. That's it, Nidhi, from my
end. So actually, I have a question about this. Could we possibly be using a voltage follower also to like make sure that the circuit doesn't react to different different load changes?
No, load changes would not affect this out over here because of the fact that you're drawing. So the amount of power that is being drawn for a buffer, it would not change. For the buffer's job is not to be affected at all by this particular concept. The buffer basically ensures only one thing, that your impedance remains on at a high value, right? But if there is a load change, exactly similar to a V2I converter, there will always be a shift in the value. So we won't be able to avoid that by using a buffer.
Okay, sir, got it. I think that's it for my lecture today. Thank you for being patient with me and answering questions today. It was a pleasure teaching you all.
Yeah. Nidhi, just one quick thing before we end. There was a lot of people had questions on the voltage compliance rule of the V2I converter. If you would want to just take that up a bit, or if you would want me to cover it later, I'll cover it later.
The voltage
compliance rule of your V2I converter.
Okay, just a second, sir. I'm actually going to go ahead and read my document once
more. Yeah. So could you just drop the reference from where you picked up the voltage compliance rule so that it helps them when they're reading that?
I picked it up from Inderjeet sir's video.
Okay. So guys, standard rule, you don't get anything ever from my lectures also. Please refer, I mean, I'm putting this on the record. Please refer to Inderjeet's lecture. All right, that's a standard rule. Right from EDC to ECAD to VLSI, anything that you ever need in terms of conceptual understanding in depth, possibly Inderjeet's lecture would be covering it. Because we have a tremendously huge amount to cover, I may not be able to cover everything in those three lectures that are present, right? Initially, we had 4 lectures in DLIC and I could still never complete the portion, right? Now the lectures are 3. Though I've cut down on the portion, I rarely believe that it's going to be possible with those 3 lectures also. Nidhi, if you have the document, fair enough, or I can explain the voltage compliance when I have the time. Shouldn't be a problem.
So I don't think I am capable of explaining it right now, but just one bit of information. I do remember that Rishi explained the voltage compliance rule last time, but he just forgot to mention the name of it. So if you watch like the ORCAD part and you watch my part, I kind of explain it with the name of voltage compliance rule, but he explains it in detail, but just doesn't happen to say the rule name.
Sure,
actually done it pretty well.
Perfect. Anyways, I'll cover this in theory, so that shouldn't be a problem. I just thought if you had something handy, they could use it as a reference. Not a problem.
I'm sorry if I would have had 10 minutes to prepare.
Not a problem. Anyways, I think that should be enough for this. Guys, I would want you all to start off when you all have time on this particular thing. To start off with, the four sub circuits that are present in experiment 6. Nidhi, again, thank you from my end as well as from the class end for these sessions. They've been very interesting for sure. So always looking forward to these sessions even after you complete your this semester. I think Nidhi's screen first. Nidhi, are you able to hear us?
Did you say anything?
No, I just said...
Yeah, I'm able to hear you now. I got
I just said that a big thank you from all of us, from the class as well as from me, for these particular sessions. They've been extremely in-depth and they've been extremely guiding in nature. So a thank you from the entire class's end as well as from my end.
Also, thank you to all of you as well. It was a great opportunity to teach this semester and the class is great. They're absolutely brilliant. The thought process is also incredible.
Right. That's true with respect to your class as well as this class, because I've enjoyed working with both the particular batches. Guys, just one sec. Yeah, so I've enjoyed actually working with your batch, and this batch is also turning out to be really interesting. So that's definitely good news, because as a batch, I always expect interesting students to be a part of your work, right? And that initiated after a pretty long time with your batch, and it's continuing with this batch. So that makes a professor really happy, actually. So again, thank you from my end as well as from the class end. Thank you guys. We'll drop off at this point. Have a very good early Sunday on a Friday. All right. So this actually counts as a Friday night. Saturday would be just a second.